Some interesting news that broke yesterday. Reddit is going to ban 2,000 different communities on subreddits that they're actually called from its platform that say that they violate hate speech policy, including the Donald. But what also caught my eye is it's not just the Donald that is getting banned, Ryan. The Donald being the largest pro-Trump subreddit. It's also the Chapo Trap House subreddit, which actually included 160,000 regular users, five times more that was in the Donald. Both this left and right subreddit are being banned for quote-unquote violation of hate speech and targeting. However, it strikes me as, once again, I think this is the overreach of neoliberalism because, again, you see who loses. And this is what I've warned here for so long. I've said whenever Twitter starts doing the fact-checking, I think you said this, too, around fact-checking political ads and many of these other things, which is that who loses? It's the anti-establishment left and the anti-establishment right. Those are the people that get targeted by these censorship campaigns. Nobody in the media is going to speak up on behalf of the Chapo Trap House subreddit. I think, you know, I mean, look, I don't really use it or whatever. I've seen a couple of posts and things like that. But what I generally have observed is it's a place for, like, DSA leftist commentary. Yeah. Sometimes it's funny in their memes. Same thing with the Donald. It's just mostly, like, a meme-making factory. And that by going after both of these communities on one of the world's largest social networking sites, which was even supposed to be anonymous and all about discussion, they're only validating the critique that we've set out here, which is that censorship by these companies always leads to one thing. If you are anti-establishment, they come for you. Maybe they didn't even want to go for the Chapo Trap House one, but because they wanted to ban the Donald, they said, we got to give the media something. Just take the Chapo one. But you think they're going to ban, like, the Hillary Clinton subreddit? Never.
Right.
Yeah.
Censorship is about power.
Yes.
I mean, Twitter, for instance, Twitter would probably have suspended Donald Trump a long time ago if he were not Donald Trump.
I mean, he's the president
of the United States. I don't think he should be suspended.
Yeah.
But censorship is about power, and so it's going to, when it's applied, hurt the people who have less
powerless
power.
Yes.
Now, you can occasionally, you know, through the organization of millions of people, organize enough power that somebody else who has power can be suppressed for a moment.
Right.
But in the long run, censorship is only going to go one direction.
That's right.
It's going to entrench the people who are already there and who already have the ability to speak, and it's going to make it more difficult for people on the margins to organize. And so, you know, there are plenty of people who will hear that and say, great, good. I don't want those people organizing. But so the Chapo Trap House Reddit, sure, but they call themselves the dirtbag left. There's going to be a lot of stuff in there that you're not proud to tell your parents about.
Sure.
And they aren't going to stand behind it. It's like, well, yeah, this is the greatest intellectual discussion.
Right. I don't even think the Chapo guys like that subreddit. But again, it doesn't even necessarily matter about what they think or not. It was a gathering point for leftists. Same thing with the Donald. It was a gathering point for people on the right. Do you know how few there are of those for both of those types of communities? Not very many. I mean, that's part of the reason I think this show does well. Apparently, we have a subreddit, although all rising, but it's not doing all that well. So maybe everybody can make that happen. But when you're looking at and you're thinking about what this means is that they're trying to kill the spaces where people of anti-establishment, right and left, can gather and discuss and have their own community. You know this. You don't think the Hillary Clinton supporters said vile things about Barack Obama in 2008?
Oh, I know they did for a fact.
They actually did. Shocker. No. Go back and read some of the Jeremiah Wright stuff and Sidney Blumenthal and all of that. Or same thing in the campaign against Sanders. I mean, the K-Hive, the Kamala people, and the things that they would say against anybody who would ever dare say a word against them. I got some very nasty fan mail and stuff from them. But I think what makes this all most insidious is that it creates censorship in the guise of protecting minorities and not majorities. And so let's throw this up on the screen. Wesley Yang, he had a screenshot of it. What it says is their new policy protects marginalized or vulnerable groups, but it specifically exempts protection from, quote, groups of people who are in the majority. Now, again, what does that mean? Because if you look at polling, anti-establishment is one of the most majoritarian groups in America, and yet they're being banned? Or you can also flip it around, which is that, well, if you're, you know, dirtbag left or you're Trump right, that is kind of a fringe online, not even fringe, but, like, in terms of our political discussion, that's a pretty minority group, right? Shouldn't they be protected? And it's all under the guise of this protection philosophy, which just ends up, in the long run, hurting the people who are trying to change the system, in my view, for the better.
They're also setting themselves up for a massive technological challenge because Reddit is an international site.
It's massive, right, yeah.
So do you have to start measuring, you know, what percentage of the users in a particular subreddit are in a particular country? Then you have to look at the numbers of the minority and majority populations in those countries. And then you have to talk to political analysts who will tell you which ones are marginalized and which ones are part of majority coalitions. And then you have to go from there and then decide if whether or not the speech is offensive enough to these particular members. You know, the internet has not been a very friendly place for a lot of people. It's gross and it's toxic. But I don't quite see the end game here for how this produces a flowering of civil discourse across the world.
And this is what I'd said about the Twitter thing, I think you probably share this, which is that if there's eventually a primary between like AOC and Chuck Schumer, you don't think that Chuck Schumer is going to try and get one of AOC's tweets about Medicare for All fact-checked? Of course it's going to happen. Will happen. And there's no question. That will happen against Jamal Bowman. That will happen against anybody running against the Democratic establishment. And now it will happen to anybody on the right running against a mainstream Democrat. Is they're going to go after you and be like, you got his fact checker this tweet. And if Twitter pairs with the Washington Post fact checker, Pinocchio's, who has no clue about economic populism, what are they going to do? We know the end result of this. And it's just so insidious because then Chuck Schumer or somebody in that type of primary could be like, look, she's lying. Look at her tweet. This is how power actually works. As you say, censorship always goes in one direction.
Yeah, I think, remember when Facebook took down an article from Think Progress, the now defunct blog?
Yes.
I don't remember exactly. We actually republished it as a kind of a protest against it being suppressed, not because we necessarily agreed with the points that it was making, but because the author had the right to make the points.
Of course.
And I can't. It was Daily Caller or somebody else was involved in the sentence. And it's like, wait a minute, Daily Caller fact checking Think Progress.
Right.
How would Daily Caller like it if Think Progress was?
And they do actually. I used to work there, so I know what happened, which is that the Daily Caller will also get fact checked by like Snopes, which is a left wing so called fact checking site. And I remember thinking at the time, like, this is all madness. Like having the Daily Caller try to fact check Think Progress and Think Progress fact check. Crazy. Just let it all exist. People are smart enough. People trust people in order to make decisions about what they want to read. I'm glad you republished it. I think it should be republished completely in full with no caveats or whatever, because I don't believe that there should be external forces trying to caveat what anybody says, because we know the results. I played for and I showed everybody here. Whenever the New York Times, remember they did those editorial board interviews with all the different senators, and under Sanders, they were like fact-checking things that he was saying on Medicare for All and immigration. Same with Elizabeth Warren. Suspiciously, the Biden one didn't have that many fact checks. Weird. I mean, again, it's like how you decide about, like, weight. The labor market is not a decided issue of facts. There is no one fact about why labor markets are where they are. They cherry pick studies. They can make anything say what they want to say. I'm sure they can do the same thing with Medicare for All or a federal jobs guarantee.
They have. Right. Glenn Kessler is the fact checker over at the Washington Post. Mm-hmm. Has repeatedly called out Bernie Sanders for statements that are supported by peer-reviewed publications. And Kessler, he and his staff will review these peer-reviewed publications and claim that they've found holes in them.
There you go.
And so
who are you?
So you could take it off the air. You could take it off social media on the word of Glenn Kessler and the Washington Post. And you then discredit the idea of these independent fact checkers, which eventually could be important, because I do think I am worried about what deepfake videos do.
So, of course.
Because at that point, like, okay, they completely fabricated a video of somebody saying something that they never actually said. If you can technologically prove that, then I think it would be incumbent on platforms to say, okay, that we're going to take
Don't disagree with that at all, but it's more about, as you say, when Reddit, who do you think Reddit looked to in order to write these policies? We all know the answer. Some diversity nonprofit or whatever, some, grifting grifting piece of all these former Democratic operatives who worked for the Obama administration or something like that. Who is Twitter going to partner with for fact check? Who is Facebook partnering with? That's something that we already all know. And so whenever all of this happens, we know that it leads to less speech and the ability for places like this show, places like your outlet, places like anybody who refuses to dance to the tune that is set for us, that our speech and our ability to organize, to speak, and to dissent is crushed. And I think that this is a deeply insidious move. And you know what? I want the Chapo subreddit back. I want the Donald subreddit back. I don't think Reddit has any business. Other than like child pornography, I don't think that they have any business taking a lot of this stuff down. But yeah. There we go. We'll have more Rising for you after this.